الحمد لله رب العالمين الصلاة والسلام على رسوله الأمين وعلى آله وأصحابه الطاهرين أما بعد فقال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتاب الله العظيم أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل بفضل الله وبرحمته فبذلك فليفرحوا هو خير مما يجمعون Sadaqallahu Nadeem. Respected President of Indian Muslim Association, Mr. Masood Chiham Sahab, Chief Guest of today's function from Ministry of Awqaf, Mr. Muhammad Ali, and moderator of today's function, Mr. Yusuf, and a very important topic discussed today by one of our another speaker, Dr. Zia Ahmed. And my dear brothers and sisters gathered here. First of all, I would like to say something about the previous topic. It's a very important topic, very interesting topic as well. If you ask, what is the purpose of Islam? The answer is to make human life just and happy. That is the purpose of Islam. For that, everything is required. Proper wealth planning is required, and if you see, that's what Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did. When he went to Medina, he transformed Medina into a stable, economically strong, beautiful, and a peaceful society, and peace for all. That is the purpose of Islam. And it is mentioned in Quran as well. لَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا رُسُلُنَا بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ وَأَنزَلْنَا مَعَهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْمِيزَانَ لِيَقُومُ النَّاسُ بِالْقِسْطِ We have sent down so many prophets and we have revealed books on them and we have given the rules and regulation of justice to them so that justice is established in human society. That is the ultimate purpose of sending down all the books and all the prophets. And we as the Muslim Ummah, it is our responsibility to make our society, our human society, wherever we are living, a happy society, a peaceful society, and a progressive society. And if you Muslims have this vision, definitely we will become leaders of the society. Today we are not leaders of the society because our vision is very small. We have to cultivate this vision. And also, probably that previous topic was not more interesting topic for our women folk, but Islam allows them to handle their economy. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's first wife was a businesswoman, and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to work for her. And also I have seen that in many Islamic societies, Muslim women have this vision, especially in Kuwait. There are many Muslim ladies who are good businesswomen. Also I have seen in Malaysia and Singapore, lot of women are very good in business. So Indian women particularly have to develop more this kind of vision, that they have to think more about how to bring a stable economy. Coming to my topic, what after Ramadan? It's again an important topic. And Alhamdulillah, by the grace of Allah, we have completed the month of Ramadan. And it is the time for us to retrospect what we have to achieve, what we have achieved in the month of Ramadan, what we have to retain and what we have to get rid of the things and habits which we have got rid of it during the month of Ramadan. We have to continuously keep ourselves away from those kind of bad habits and cultivate and acquire all the good things which we have acquired during the month of Ramadan. And when we see that whether Ramadan has brought any change in us or not, some of us, maybe for example, if you are 50 years old, you might have seen 51 month of Ramadan, because every 30 years there will be one additional month according to Lunar year. In 50 years, if you are not changed, will there be any change in coming 30 years, 40 years, or 20 years, or 10 years, whatever you are going to live, will it bring any change? Why this is happening? Every time month of Ramadan comes, you will see some people are changed. They are going to prayer, they are doing so many virtues, they are doing so many good things. Once the Ramadan, month of Ramadan is gone, they are back to same. And nothing changed in their life. Why it is? Because there is a sunnah about change. there is a tradition about change by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah ta'ala says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِكِمْ. Allah ta'ala will not change any community unless they change themselves. Again Allah ta'ala says, ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّ اللَّهُ. It is the tradition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لَمْ يَكُ مُغَيِّرًا نِعْمَةً عَنْعَمَهَا عَلَىٰ قَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala will not change the blessings given to any community unless they change themselves. So for change, what is necessary is a strong inclination to change oneself. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala facilitate the change and bless you with the change, but gives you opportunity to have that inclination of change. This is very much necessary, that we have to decide that we will change. I will change myself. Then only it is possible for you to change. In the month of Ramadan, so many people change themselves. I was reading the biography or life history of Noman Ali Khan. Noman Ali Khan was an ordinary man, and until he passed from the college, he was not a good Muslim. And what changed him is one month of Ramadan. He attended tafsir class for the entire month, and after the month of Ramadan, he was a different person. And within a short span of time, he became a great Islamic scholar and today a popular Islamic speaker around the world. And what changed him is the month of Ramadan. So what changed him is a strong inclination that I have to change myself. And that is what is necessary, that you have to have a strong inclination that I have to change myself. Instead of talking about big things, let me talk about small things which everybody can implement in our life and everybody can follow in our life. For example, Salatul Fajr. It's not easy for many people, and particularly in this part of the world, because the time of the Salatul Fajr is very early. But in the month of Ramadan, I have seen, and you all might have seen, that masajid were full. There was no place to enter and there was no place to keep your shoes and slippers, because people are getting up for pre-dawn meal for suhoor, and they used to go to masjid. And what happened all of a sudden on second day of Shawwal, if you go to masjid, there was a message that the WhatsApp status of the imam was feeling lonely because there is nobody in the masjid on the Shawwal second or the next day of Eid, and there is only imam sahab and the muadhin and a traveler and a beggar maybe, because he beggar for him masjid is a shelter. Other than that, you will not find anybody in the masjid. What happened? Because people are lacking that strong inclination of change. So first of all, we have to disobey. Most of you pray five times. That's why I'm not talking about praying five times. And if somebody is missing Fajr prayer, this is the time that we have to make a strong decision that we will not miss any of our Fajr prayer. Because according to psychologists, 21 days, if you follow certain things regularly and continuously, it is easy for you to change your behavior. Allah Ta'ala has given us opportunity to change your behavior by giving 1 month of Ramadan. If you have prayed 1 month continuously in the month of Ramadan, and if you have gone to Fajr prayer, then it is definitely easy for you compared to the previous days. So we have to make a resolution that we will not miss any of our Fajr prayers, and we will go to pre-dawn prayer or dawn prayer every day. And again, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man sallal burdaini dakhal al jannah." Those who pray the prayers of two times, and burdain means the Fajr prayer and the Asr prayer, they will definitely enter paradise. So these are the important prayers. Normally people miss, because during the Asr prayer people are sleeping. Again, during the Fajr prayer people are sleeping. So easy way out is to make sure that you pray these two prayers. So we have to make a resolution about that. And also Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Fil bukuri barakah." And there is in early dawn, when you get up early dawn, when you start your day with dawn, then there will be a lot of barakah. Barakah means abundance. And the same money you are earning, there will be more results and more productivity. In your time, there is more productivity. In your family, there will be more productivity. Barakah is an important concept. And if you miss barakah, you miss everything. You see a lot of people earn a lot of money, but end of the day, they have nothing. I have a story of one of my friend. When he went to Saudi Arabia to start his Gulf career, he had a small plantation. He sold it to buy a visa and to arrange his tickets and everything. And he stayed there in Saudi Arabia for 20 years. And he did everything, and after that he thought of coming back and settling down. And finally, with his money, he purchased the same plantation, which he sold 20 years back, with a lot of money. And he is again the same, back to the same person. But what happens, 20 years is just a struggle. So this is missing the barakah. So this is what, you know, you should not miss barakah. And one of the important things not to miss barakah is to get up early in the morning and start your day with fajr prayer. So we have to make a resolution that we will not miss any of our fajr prayer. Again, in the month of Ramadan, one of the training we have achieved is praying during Qiyamul Layl. Qiyamul Layl or Taraweeh or Tahajjud, it's all same. Taraweeh, the name is given because there are intervals. Tarweeh means interval, there are intervals between the prayers. Qiyamul Layl is the same thing and Tahajjud is the same thing. And when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he has to face so many challenges, Allah ta'ala gave him a clue that what he had to do in order to be more successful and in order to be more productive in your life. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَمِنَ اللَّيْلِ فَتَهَجَّدْ بِهِ نَافِلَةً لَكْ. And we have made you tahajjud, that is getting up in the night, an optional thing for you. And it was optional for Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when Allah ta'ala says optional, it is very near to compulsory. And it is again, when Allah ta'ala says this to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is also an advice to everybody that it is an optional thing that you have to get up for tahajjud prayer in the nights. And وَعَسَىٰ أَن يَبْعَسَكَ رَبُّكَ مُقَامًا مَحْمُودًا. And if you do that, Allah ta'ala will elevate your status and they give you the status of glory. This is the secret. If you want to be successful and if you want to people to remember you with appreciation, then what is necessary is tahajjud prayer. It was a clue given to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam again advised it to the community, Muslim community. So tahajjud prayer may not be regular every day. If you cannot do it every day, if you can do it every day, that is well and good. Particularly during winter season, when Fajr prayer is very late, it is easy for anyone to get up half an hour before Fajr prayer. Maybe in summer it is difficult. But in summer also during weekends and whenever you can do it, if you have shift system in your work, then it is easy for you. So again, develop this, praying for the praying tahajjud, because it will elevate your status and people will see you with appreciation. And you will get a status of maqam-e-mahmood, means a status of glory that is possible only when you pray for tahajjud prayer. Again, this one we have to cultivate. And the third thing we have cultivated during the month of Ramadan is charity, giving. And charity, one is compulsory charity, which is zakat. Another one is optional charities. In the month of Ramadan, normally people separate their income as a zakat, and you need not have to spend all your zakat money in the month of Ramadan, because there are needs in month of Shaaban, there is needs in month of Rajab. So you can separate it and you can spend it. And you can give it to the institution who are spending the zakat money. Though the real advice by Prophet Muhammad was to have a collective system of zakat, but unfortunately it is not there. There is no collective system of zakat. It is very unfortunate, and we should always feel that this is not something Islamic. It's not Islamic, by the way. Individually paying zakat is not very Islamic. It was given by a fatwa when Baghdad was attacked by Mongolians and there was no Islamic government. Then ulamas gave fatwa that it is permitted for Muslims to give zakat individually. Otherwise it was not permitted. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not permit anybody to give zakat individually. Because we should have our own society and we should have our collective system. If we don't have it, we always have an urge to establish that kind of society and that kind of system. though we are giving it individually, but we should have that vision, we should have that urge that is necessary as a Muslim for us. So when we are paying charity, a different kind of personality is evolved. Your personality, you will become more generous person. You will become a person having social concern, and people will see you with respect. And bukhl and iman cannot stay in the same place. Stinginess and belief cannot stay in the same place. A believer is a very generous person, and Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala develops this kind of broad-mindedness and this kind of generosity in every individual Muslim. And that needs spending. If you see, I have seen myself, couples who have no kids are less generous compared to couples who have a lot of kids. Because couples, when they are spending for kids, it's a daily practice for them. Spending is necessary, and kids need a lot of money, and you have to spend for them. You can see that they are more generous. Couples with more kids, they are more generous. And couples with no kids, they are less generous because they have no practice of spending. So Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala uses many opportunities. One is a compulsory charity which everybody has to give, whoever is wealthy. And if you are not wealthy enough, even then there is opportunity for you to give charity. Whatever you can give charity, you have to give. For example, Zakatul Fitr, the early morning charity during the day of Eid, it is on every individual. If you have an income of that day, if you have a sustenance of that day, you have to give charity on behalf of every individual from your family. So this is compulsory on every individual. Like that, Islam gives more opportunity for individuals to develop the habit of charity, and then you become more generous person. Then you will become a person having social concern, and you will see, people will see you with appreciation. And Allah likes the people who are generous. People also like the people who are more generous. So this kind of habit we have to cultivate. And when we are giving charity to the poor people, again, we have to identify what kind of poor people we have to spend. We should not forget, for example, especially I can say in the background of Indian subcontinent, there are some poor people. About them, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala mentions in Surah Al-Baqarah, chapter number 2 and verse number 283, لِلْفُقَرَىٰ الَّذِينَ أُحْصِرُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. Among the poor people, some are those who are striving in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَلَّذِينَ لَا يَسْتَطِيعُونَ ضَرْبًا فِي الْأَرْضِ. And because of their dedication for the Islamic activities, they don't have time for earning, for their own economic activity, for all economic well-being. They cannot think of, because they are fully indulged and dedicated themselves in Islamic activities or the betterment of a Muslim society. And يَحْسَبُهُمُ الْجَاهِلُ أَغْنِيَاءَ فِي التَّعَفُّفِ. And the ignorant people think that they are the rich people. They are wealthy people because of their, you know, the kind of life they lead, and they are not going, stretching their hands, asking people. That's why a lot of ignorant people think that these are rich people. And تَعْرَفُهُمْ بِسِيمَاهُمْ. In spite of that, you can see, by seeing their faces, you can understand that these are the needy people. لَا يَسْأَلُونَ النَّاسَ إِلْحَافًا. And they are not asking people, stretching their hands. So that kind of poor people are also there, who are dedicated to the cause of Islam. Identify them and make arrangement for them. That is very much necessary, because we in Indian subcontinent are facing a lot of challenges to retain the Islamic spirit and for the development of the Islamic society. A lot of people are working, and do not ignore them. They are poor people, they are needy people. Your charity should go to them. And again, some people may be thinking that we are not rich enough, what we can do. In Islam, charity is not only about money. Charity is whatever good things. Being a generous person is always a charity. And who is the most stingiest person? If you see, most stingiest person who cannot smile, that is the most stingiest person, that he has no compassion, he has nothing, no generosity in his heart, just to smile even. That is the most stingiest person, because Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, تَبَسُّمُكَ بِوَجْهِ أَخِيهِ صَدَقًا. If you have no money, or even if you have money, smile at your brother. That is a charity. That is the minimum thing you can do. And sometimes people pay charity, then think that This person should always be thankful to me. Lifelong he should be thankful to me. Are you keep telling people that this man, I have helped him. I have made him to be like this today. If today whatever you can see him, that is all because of me. So this is not appreciated in Islam. Islam says, قَوْلُ مَعْرُوفٌ وَمَغْفِرَةٌ خَيْرٌ مِنْ صَدَقَةٍ يَتْبَوْهَا عَذَابٌ. A best word, a polite word, and forgiveness is better than a charity by which you always expect that he should be thankful to you. Say that I don't have money or I cannot support you, but I have real inclination to support you. But what I can do you is a good suggestion, or what I can give you is to lead to the person who you can support you. So this kind of nice words is better than sometimes charity, and better than, definitely better than always expecting him to be thankful to you. This is not allowed in Islam. So this kind of generous personality we have to develop. And Quran says, وَمَنْ يُوقَ شُحَّ نَفْسِهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمَ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. Whoever is protected from the stinginess of the heart, he is successful. So again, in the month of Ramadan, we were giving charity. We have to develop this kind of generosity in our personality, that people should start liking us. And Allah Ta'ala will also like the people who are generous. So this is one more thing we have to develop in the month of Ramadan and after the month of Ramadan. Again, one important thing we have to develop is to have strengthen and to re-establish our relationship with Quran. And while we are re-establishing our relationship with Quran, let me remind you with the beautiful quotation of Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And this is applicable to every aspect of our life. Prophet Muhammad SAW said, Al-Qaleelu Da'imu Khayrun Min Kathirul Munqata. Anything which you do regularly, even if it is small, is better than anything you do abundantly but with intervals. This is what we do with the Quran in the month of Ramadan. We read a lot. We complete the whole Quran in the month of Ramadan. We read it during Fajr, during night, during Qiyamul Layl, and everything. After the month of Ramadan, we keep Quran with all respect inside a nice place where nobody will reach, and you will also not reach there unless you get next Ramadan in your life. This is what you do in the month of Ramadan. This is not really appreciable. What Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said is, Al-Qaleelu Da'imu, even if you read one line, or two lines, or two ayah, or three ayah, or 15 minutes. Do it regularly, every day. And by the end of the year, you will know that how much you have accumulated. There is a lot of barakah in it. When you do it small, little, but continuously, there is a lot of barakah in it. See, for example, when I see honeybees, it's a small bee, and it will carry a small portion of honey from the flowers to the beehive. But it works regularly, continuously, and there is a team spirit. And after that end of the year, you will get several liters of honey. Why? Because it is regular, though it is small, it is regular and with teamwork. This is what is necessary for our life as well. Do it, do any good things, little, but very regularly. Also develop your own team. If you think that I don't have team, your family members could be your team. Develop your wife and your children and your friends and your near neighbors or your colleagues in such a way that they are supportive to your good cause. And if you don't have anyone, join the team. For example, IMA is doing good job, join with IMA or something, some team, some other team, whichever team you find it is good for you to join. Join with them, do anything regularly. And this is very much important. And also in the Quran, it is necessary that we should have regular contact. Not like in the month of Ramadan, we have read a lot and maybe we never try to understand it. That should not be the case. Try to understand Quran. Read even one verse, understand it, ponder over it, and see after one year, in the next Ramadan, you will be a different person. Try, start from today that I will read only one verse, I will read it with meaning, and I will ponder over the meaning. After 1 year, you will be a different person. So this is what is necessary. This should be our relationship with Quran. And one more thing is, in the month of Ramadan, Allah Ta'ala, whenever He talks about month of Ramadan, He talks, first thing He talks is about Quran. For example, about fasting, There are only three verses in Quran. Surah Al-Baqarah, chapter number 183. Surah number 183, 84 and 85. These are the three verses in Quran. Other than that, nowhere fasting is mentioned. And in the first verses, كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ السِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. And fasting is prescribed for you as it is prescribed for your previous generations, so that you may become more pious people. This is the first verse. And these verses are not about month of Ramadan. According to major scholars, these verses were regarding the fasting which was compulsory before Ramadan. Before the fasting of month of Ramadan was compulsory, there were some fast which was compulsory for Muslims. And Muslims used to fast. And this talks about that. Because the next verse says, Ayyamam Ma'dudat. This is some days, matter of some days. Or in Urdu, Ginti Ke Chand Din. So Ma'dudat is less than 10 days. So that's why this verse talks about the fasting which was compulsory to Muslims before Ramadan. And about month of Ramadan, what Quran says, when Quran mentions, Quran is not mentioning about fast in the beginning. Quran first mentions about Quran. شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن. That is the first thing Quran mentions. Before fasting, it mentions about Quran and highlights the importance of Quran and says, month of Ramadan is the month in which Quran is revealed. Second thing is, the introduction of Quran is given. What is Quran? هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان. It is a guidance for the entire human being, and there are clear cut injunctions of guidance, and it is a criterion to distinguish between truth and falsehood. This is the introduction of Quran. Then Quran says, فَمَنْ شَهِدَ مِنْكُمُ الشَّهْرَ فَلْيَصُمْ. And if you live in this month of Ramadan, if you find this month of Ramadan, then you have to fast in the month of Ramadan, because it is the month in which Quran is revealed. The most highlighted stress is there for Quran. So we have to understand that this is the month of Quran. And again, there is a big relationship with the Quran and Muslim community. If you see the whole Surah Al-Baqarah is divided into major division is two parts. The first part, if you see from Alif Lam Mim, it talks about Bani Israel, how were the community and what were their mistakes. All these things are mentioned in Surah Al-Baqarah. And in between is there is a mention of fasting. And before that, Allah Ta'ala also mentioned about Muslim Ummah. A Muslim Ummah is generated, a Muslim Ummah is created. Allah Ta'ala sent down again Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam as per the supplication of Prophet Ibrahim Alayhi Salaam. Ibrahim Alayhi Salaam supplicates and says, وَبْعَثْ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ يَتْلُوْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِكَ. Here Ibrahim Alayhi Salaam supplicates for two things. One is رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ. Send down one prophet. He did not ask for sending down many prophets. From this generation, send down one prophet. There were always prophets after Ibrahim Alayhi Salaam in the community of Bani Ishaq. Prophets came one after the other until Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam. And there was no time when there were no prophets. Every time there were prophets. And after Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, people were waiting for another prophet. No one came. Almost 500 years. This was first time in the history of prophethood. It happened that 500 years there were no prophets. And finally, the supplication was accepted and the prophet came, the one prophet came who is in the family of Ismail, who is Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And again the supplication of Prophet Muhammad, Prophet Ibrahim was accepted. يَتْلُوْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِكَ. He rehearses the verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that verses were given, Quran was given. And again Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa sallam supplicated, وَجَعَلْنَا مُسْلِمَيْنِ لَكَ وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِنَا أُمَّةً مُسْلِمَةً لَكْ. Make us Muslims, me and my son Ismail, and bring forth a Muslim community from among this generation, this people. So Allah Ta'ala develops a Muslim community. So Allah Ta'ala brings a prophet and gives Quran to them and make them their followers a Muslim community. And finally what is required is a And also Allah Ta'ala gives a capital to Muslims. Makkah was the capital. Because when Allah Ta'ala, when Prophet Muhammad was looking towards the cell, Allah Ta'ala understands it and says that قَدْ نَرَى تَقَلُّبَ وَجْهِكَ فِي السَّمَاءِ فَلَنُوَلِّيَنَّكَ قِبْلَةً تَرْضَاهَا فَوَلِّ وَجْهَكَ شَطْرَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ. We are seeing that you are stretching your faces towards the sky, and we will turn your face towards the Qibla, which is very dearer to you. Turn your face towards Masjid al-Haram. These injunctions were given. So Prophet is there, Muslim community is there, and the capital for Muslims are given. And finally, what is necessary is the constitution. The constitution is given to Muslims. So we have to understand Quran as our constitution. And we have to follow it, we have to understand it. And we have to see that what change it should bring in my society. And also we have to see that what change Quran want to bring in our society. This way we have to look into Quran. That's why you can see that we read Quran, whatever we do with the Quran, we read it. And sometimes we rehearse it beautifully. And sometimes when we have to make a pledge, we will take Quran in our hands. And sometimes we read it for barakah. And sometimes we read it for shifa. And sometimes, you know, for all these things we do with Quran. Quran is for everything. For shifa also you can read it. For barakah also you can read it. And for all these things you can read it. But none of them are the purpose of revelation of Quran. It's not the objective of revelation of Quran. That's not the objective. The objective of revelation of Quran is to change society. So without keeping this objective in our mind, whatever you do, there will be no change in your personality, there will be no change in your society. If you see, after Quran came, if you see two ages, one is pre-Quran age, one is post-Quran age, there was a big change. Makkah was a society of uneducated people, and Medina was more uneducated people, less educated than Makkah, because in the Battle of Badr, Prophet Muhammad asked the prisoners to teach language to people of Medina, because they were very less educated. But after certain years, imagine, after 17 years, Muslims were the conquerors of the two biggest civilizations, which had hundreds of thousands of people and very big area, Roman civilization and the Persian civilization, which was conquered after the 17th year of migration of Prophet Muhammad. Very small time, very little time Muslims conquered. And after 100 years, Tariq bin Ziyad led the army and conquered Europe. Spain was conquered. And after 100 years, Muslims has the biggest land. And Muslims were the most prosperous people economically. And most educated people. And in culture, they were the most prosperous people. And if you want to find out one reason why Muslims are so prosperous, only after 100 years of revelation of Quran, the reason is Quran. Quran which brought the changes in the people, and it's Quran which brought the changes in the society. And today Quran is not bringing any change within us. Why? Because we are not addressing the Quran in such a way. There is a beautiful couplet by Mahir al-Qadri. He writes about Quran, that Quran ki fariyat. He has written a beautiful poem. He says, taqon mein sajaya jata hoon, aankhon se lagaya jata hoon, taaveez banaya jata hoon, dho dho ke pilaya jata hoon. Mujhse mohabbat ke daave qanoon pe razi ghairon ke yun bhi mujhe ruswa karte hain yun bhi main sataya jata hun. So this says that we are keeping it on the top of the our cupboard, and we also sometimes touches it to our eyes in respect, and we also make amulet of it for so many things. And sometimes we say that we love Quran, but we are more satisfied and we are very happy with the rules and regulations and theories given by others. And this way you are humiliating Quran, and this way you are disrespecting Quran. How can you bring change within yourself? How can you bring change within society? So our approach should be different towards Quran. And after the month of Ramadan, we have to make a pledge that I will have a good relationship with Quran. I will try to understand Quran. And I will have a strong urge, as Prophet Muhammad ﷺ had, as his companions had, as the Muslim community had every time, that I will have a strong urge to change the society based on the principles of Quran. This kind of relationship we should have with Quran. And finally, since my time is running out, Let me tell a small incident of Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala. When he went to Hajj and he was in the plains of Arafat, he started weeping. People asked him, he was Khalifa at that time, people asked him, "O Khalifa of the time, what makes you weep?" He said, "This is the same plains of Arafat where I used to bring my camel for grazing my camel. And once my father Khattab slapped at me and he said, 'O Umar, if you are not good enough to make arrangement for your camel to graze properly, what can you do? What achievement do you have in your life?' And this was my status. I was not good enough even for grazing camels. I was not, my worth was that much. But Prophet came between us and the revelation of Quran happened. And after that today, I am the Khalifa of the people, Khalifa of such a big empire. Roman Empire and Persian Empire included, with Syria, Jordan, and some part of Iran and Iraq and all these areas he was ruling. He was a big Khalifa of the big empire. So he said, this is all because of Quran. So Quran brings the changes. Only it brings the changes if you have this kind of vision and outlook towards the Quran. And finally, let me talk about what is the purpose of fasting, including the fasting in the month of Ramadan. Quran says, the fasting in general, the purpose is كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. And the purpose of fasting is لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, so that you may become pious. What is piety? Again, taqwa. What is taqwa? The beautiful explanation is given by Ubay bin Ka'ab radiallahu ta'ala. He said, taqwa is as if you are going between a thorny bushes. When you are going between thorny bushes, you protect yourself. And the whole life you try to protect yourself, then you are muttaqi. Protect yourself from evil things. Protect yourself from wrong things. Protect yourself from anything wrong which goes wrong. Be cautious always. This is what is taqwa. But you can see that in the month of Ramadan, everybody is muttaqi. Everybody is coming in the month to the masjid. As soon as Ramadan is gone, you will not see any muttaqi anymore. So this is not the way of taqwa. Taqwa should be always. The requisite of taqwa is وَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. You should not die unless you are a believer. This is the requisite of taqwa, that taqwa should be constant. And again, there is a beautiful explanation of taqwa. The verses recited by Master Abdul Rahman in the beginning of this program, which is called Ayatul Birr, chapter number 2, Suratul Baqarah, and verse number 177. Beautiful explanation of what is taqwa. The verse says, لَيْسَ الْبِرَّ أَن تُوَلُّوا وُجُوهَكُمْ قِبَلَ الْمَشْرِقِ وَالْمَغْرِبِ. It is not virtue that you are turning your face towards east or west. That's not the virtue. But what is virtue? Virtue is وَلَكِنَّ الْبِرَّ مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْمَلَائِكَةِ وَالْكِتَابِ وَالنَّبِيِّينَ. The virtue is to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to believe in angels and to believe in books and believe in prophets. Means you should have a strong belief. In the sense, belief means the belief should change you. You should have a strong belief within you that nothing externally should change you. Whatever the situation, when you have belief, means a set of principles you are believing in, then nothing will change you. You cannot compromise with the belief in whatever situation. This is the first requisite of taqwa, that you should have a strong belief and you should have certain principles and ideas for your life. And in any circumstances, you should follow these ideas. This is the first requisite of taqwa. What is the second requisite? وَآتَ الْمَالَ عَلَىٰ حُبِّهِ ذَوِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْيَتَامَى وَالْمَسَاكِينِ وَابْنِ السَّبِيلِ وَالصَّائِلِينَ وَفِي الرِّقَابِ. And the second requisite is you should spend your money for the poor, for the needy, for the orphans, for the wayfarer, and for those who are in need, who are stretching their hands, and for the emancipation of slavery, and these kind of things. The second requisite of taqwa is you should spend money. A lot of people, they say, if it is praying, I'll pray 2 more rakats. And if it's fasting, I'll pray for 2 more days, because all is free. When it comes to friending, he says, no, people are reluctant. So people here says, taqwa means you should be generous enough to spend. And you should identify the people. You should have a great social concern. Spending means you should have a great social concern. You cannot be a believer and you are least concerned about the society. You cannot be a good believer. So you should be a concerned person, you should have a strong social concern, and you should be generous person. This is the second requisite of taqwa. And final, the third requisite is wa aqamu salata wa atu zakat. Prayer is mentioned after that, that you should be establishing prayer and giving charity. And finally, it says wal mufuna bi ahdihim idha ahadu. And whenever you make a pledge or promise, you should be fulfilling those promises. Again, the believer means the word is enough for him. In the olden days, when people were doing business, how people in Medina became good business people? They didn't have any contracts to make. They believed in people that, okay, you give a word to him, that's sufficient for him. He will follow that pledge. And why the people of Indonesia and Malaysia became Muslims? People, Da'at, or people with the Islamic message did not go there. Traders went there and they were doing business. Their word, their dealing was so honest that people looked at them, they said, these are the honest people and we can trust on them. And they understood their ideals, they came to the fold of Islam. And today you will find largest number of Muslims in that region, poorest countries. They were doing business. And people from India, people from Arab countries went there. And with the influence, people came to the fold of Islam. So again, this is what is necessary, that when you make a pledge and when you make a promise, your word should be so trustworthy. This is the requisite of taqwa. And also, وَالصَّابِرِينَ فِي الْبَأْسَاءِ وَالضَّرَّاءِ وَحِينَ الْبَأْسِ. And in this situation of the difficulties and torments, and also during the struggle of Islam, you should be showing your patience. Life is full of challenges. Muslims may also face challenges. During the challenges, you should not make compromise and you should not run away from Islam. And you should say that this time is different. We have to make our own compromises. We have to live differently. That's not the case. In every time they have ideas and set of principles they follow, and they should be patient to steadfast, being steadfast with those principles. أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ صَدَقُوا وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمَ الْمُتَّقُونَ. They are the people who are the realistic people, they are the truthful people, and they are the muttaqeen. So see the explanation of taqwa, it's not very simple. Today we want to, if you want to see the muttaqi, we can see that if a person has a long beard or a short kind of dress, people think that he is muttaqi. Taqwa has exterior examples also, maybe long beard, he is an example of muttaqi, maybe. But Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his ahadith never mentioned that see the exterior things and identify that he is muttaqi. I have seen in my personal life, maybe you might also have seen, that people with, you know, very Islamic look and in their dress, in their exterior looks, they look very much Islamic, very much muttaqi. But they are not courteous, they are not polite, their dealing is not good. Also some females I have seen, they wear niqab, they do everything, they look very much muttaqi. But in their behavior, in their attitude, they are not. So is that taqwa? That taqwa cannot be like that, because Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never said that by exterior look you can develop taqwa. But he said, at-taqwa ha-huna. Taqwa is here. He is showing the heart. He said, taqwa is here. And when you change this one, if you have a better attitude, you are muttaqi. Even, you know, the attitude, for example, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, الَّذِينَ يَغُضُّونَ أَصْوَاتَهُمْ عِنْدَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ امْتَحَنَ اللَّهُ قُلُوبُهُمْ لِلتَّقْوَى. When people are toning down their voice when addressing Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, addressing politely, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has tested their hearts for taqwa. Here Allah tabarak wa ta'ala talks about the tone of your voice. It's very important. For example, if you call somebody and from the other side somebody answers, hello. Usually, if you are a smart man, you understand it is the owner of the house or the, you know, servant of the house. You understand. Also by hello, you understand that he is an educated man or an uneducated man. Also by hello, sometimes you understand he is an arrogant man or polite man. Only by hello, need not have to even talk to them. So tone is very important, and 80% of the impact is by your tone, not by your language. So here Allah tabarak wa ta'ala says, if you, when you talk to Prophet Muhammad, when you keep your tone down, then Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has tested taqwa of your heart. So it shows how the attitude, the how we behave, all these things are counted in taqwa. So taqwa is a very broad concept, it is not limited concept. So when we have to change our attitude, mend our attitude, develop a personality which is a requisite of a muttaqi. So this is what is the requirement of fasting in the month of Ramadan. So these are some of the requirements. So I have given you simple principles which you can follow. Make sure that you get up for the Fajr prayer, which will give a lot of barakah and abundance in your life. And get up for tahajjud prayer sometimes. It will make your status a status of glory. And be a generous person and continue your charity. And re-strengthen your relationship with your Quran. And that relationship will be meaningful. That is not just a, you know, the traditional relationship, but it should be a revolutionary and meaningful relationship with Quran. And ultimately we should be muttaqi. We should understand the broader concept of taqwa and we have to follow it. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala give us blessing to understand this personally to myself and all of us. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.